Welcome to the testing academy, guys. Just tell me, like, what exactly is a selenium in the comments? What do you think about it? All right.
The official statement, right? Whenever if someone asks you in interview, right, don't tell these things, especially related to UI automation, something like this, right? It's basically, if I say it's Selenium is just used to automate browsers. That's it. It's a C. I know it's very simple. In a nutshell, Selenium is an open source free suite. It's a suite which contains three major components, right? So if we talk about most of the time, whenever you are saying Selenium, you are talking about Selenium WebDriver. But please note that Selenium also contains Selenium IDE as well as Selenium Grid. Selenium Grid is one of the important thing whenever you are coming at a level of 5 years, 6 years, right? You have to use Selenium Grid, right? Probably you are using cloud ones like BrowserStack, SourceLab, or LambdaTest. But if you are creating your local grids, definitely you need to use that Selenium Grid, right? So that is again, it's a part of Selenium. So whenever we say Selenium, it's basically consist of, if I say, it's basically consist of three major components, which is Selenium WebDriver, Selenium Grid, and Selenium IDE, right? So let me show you what do you mean by this. If you go to their official website, right? Even if you go to the official website, right? And if you see, they are basically saying, telling you that we have drivers, IDE, and Grid, right? Most of the people, whenever generally I ask these kind of question, like what is Selenium? The first question is that it basically a tool which basically automate browsers, right? That is again simple thing, but they are mainly focusing on the WebDriver part of it, where they can automate the things by using the WebDriver interface. But the problem here is that if we talk about single-handedly Selenium, right? It's basically a combination of Selenium IDE plus Selenium Grid, right? So these three are the major components in Selenium. Make sense, guys? Type one in the comment if made sense. So whenever in interview, if someone asks you about it, make sure you explain this, that this is Selenium. It consists WebDriver, IDE, and Grid, right? So there are like a couple of old concepts related to RC, remote control. I'm not covering that thing. I'm covering all the new things which are right now working, and people are asking about the right now things, right? What is WebDriver? What is IDE? What is Grid? And trust me, whenever you are at a level of 3 to 4 years, people are asking mostly about this, which is grid level concepts. And they know that you have probably worked on this one, but you are missing this thing, which is the how you can basically create your Selenium Grid, which supports parallel execution. Right? Why they remove RC? RC they haven't removed. They basically integrated with the WebDriver. They basically moved in between. So RC plus WebDriver is now WebDriver, kind of a thing. They haven't removed it completely. It's a part of it. So they have merged it. And even if you know Selenium 4, grid part is completely new, which is quite complex. I'm gonna cover few aspects of it, which will again, if you see. Right now we were using Selenium Grid, which was grid 3 most of the time, and right now we have grid 4, which is again advanced concept related to how you can use it in a like a couple of new things that have introduced, right? So we'll go one by one also. Okay, so if anyone asks you in a simple way, it's basically an automation which basically helps you to automate browser, right? And so let's see why we need Selenium, guys. Type in the comment what do you think why we need Selenium, if you need. So let's if so again so the first point is very simple, which is that Selenium is free and open source. That's why people are using it. And right now in the industry, if we talk about industry centers, right, most of the companies are using Selenium right now. And probably because of these things, I'm gonna tell you why. Selenium helps you to automate the web browsers. It's a suite containing Selenium IDE, Grid, and Selenium 4 right now, which is called as WebDriver plus RC, right? Selenium Grid, if we talk about Selenium Grid only, it basically solves the problem of the parallel execution, which is the most important thing. as well as Selenium Grid helps you to reduce your number of test cases. Now, one of the important question here is that generally people ask you in interview that how do I reduce my number of test cases? For example, I have 5,000 test cases that I have automated with Selenium, right? I'm running in a single computer. How do I reduce this to this execution time? Probably they are taking 1 hour to do that, right? How do I make sure that these are executed in 30 minutes? Probably in if these are independent test cases, how I can do that? So the simplest answer will be setting up a grid mechanism, right? It grid can be on your AWS server. It can be a local, right? It can be a Docker base. It totally depends upon you. But the concept here is that if you want to reduce your number of test cases, you can leverage this Selenium grid concept, right? So again, why we need Selenium? It's very simple. Manual testing, especially related to regression, is boring. If someone says manual testing is boring, it doesn't mean actually. Basically, manual testing, most of the time we'll be doing for new features. But if you are doing the same thing again and again, it basically becomes your regression, right? So regression, again, testing regression is boring. As well as one of the important thing why we need Selenium is because it supports multiple browsers, right? It supports Chrome, Firefox, Opera, and a couple of IE, right? Which is most important ones. And OSS, it basically works on Windows, Linux, and Mac, pretty much covers maximum things. Programming language, it supports Java, Ruby, Python, and C Sharp, like a couple of important programming languages. That's why we need Selenium. And this is one of the important question, why we need Selenium. Let's talk about why, when we don't need Selenium. Type in the comment, guys, when we don't need Selenium. What are the limitations of Selenium if I talk about, if there are people who already know, right? Can you type in comments, what are the limitations of Selenium? Desktop app, absolutely. Nilan is absolutely right. Desktop automation, okay. Any other thing apart from desktop and mobile, absolutely right. When there is no need, no UI. Okay, bitmap comparison, of course, yes. Image comparison, image work, testing images, right? It is not supported in Selenium. CAPTCHA, of course, yes, absolutely. Right, so let's come. Selenium can only automate web application. This is actually one of the, sometimes people are confused that Selenium can automate desktop and mobile. Make sure you know this, that it's only supports web application automation. You cannot automate mobile applications, nor support for desktop application. That is again, yes. As well as performance testing, you cannot do by using Selenium, right? No support for reporting features, right? This is major drawback in Selenium, that it doesn't support any kind of a reporting mechanism. Like we have, if you talk about other comparing frameworks like Cypress and all, they have inbuilt analytics as well as reporting, right? That's where the Selenium lacks. Selenium has a hard time handling the dynamic elements. And trust me, this is one of the important thing that which is limitation of Selenium also. So if you have dynamic elements, so let me show you what exactly it's a dynamic elements. Dynamic elements are generally which have dynamic class names, IDs, right? And they are dynamically created over the whenever we are loading the page, right? So generally e-commerce websites, if you have seen like Amazon or Flipkart, if you try to use their ID and classes, right, they will again own these on the page refresh or sometimes their whole page classes as well as their ID logic changes and they have some dynamic part in it, right? So Selenium has very hard time in handling. There's another way to do that, but trust me, we have faced it. Selenium has very, very hard time handling dynamic elements. And I'm going to show you one of the website which is made in AngularJS, right? My previous company website, where the old elements, most of the elements that we have seen related to class as well as the ID are dynamic in nature. And the Selenium, we had like lots of different problems due to this, where we were nearly impossible to automate those things, those web pages in Angular, right? But we had certain mechanism to do that. So I'm going to show you how you can do that also. What is the option? Which tool is the best for the suggestion for dynamic element? I would say not best. The dynamic elements are generally the elements which basically their IDs and classes. These are basically continuously changing after the page load or page refreshes. Selenium has a hard time in handling the dynamic elements, right? Selenium doesn't provide any support for test management tool. This is one of the important thing. Like we have ALM, UFT, right? They are couple of test management tools, and integration with Selenium, it's quite hard. Still now we are working on it, most of the people right now using Selenium, but that's again the challenge that Catalon Studio has identified. And if you see Catalon Studio, it's a kind of a end-to-end managed platform where it provides automation as well as managing your test cases also, right? If any of you have been using Catalon, right, free version even, right, it's pretty much a complete suite. But the problem here is the pricing. Again, pricing of Catalon is quite high, I would say. Even Cybrus, if you see, Cybrus is again moving towards mixing up the same, on the same path of Catalon. It is going towards the test management plus test suites and test frameworks. So again, I would say a couple of competition is coming towards Selenium in that case, right? If we talk about limitation of Selenium, right, we have video testing, audio testing, CAPTCHA, barcode. A couple of folks have already talked about, discussed about the CAPTCHA. You cannot automate video testing, right? I have been into video testing part where Selenium is nearly a zero, if you say, for me. Means Selenium doesn't help anywhere. If we want to do any kind of a video player testing or anything related to, we have like web players to test it out, right? If we have a video like Vimeo where, right? So we have to use certain different libraries to perform any kind of a video testing, right? So that's where it lags very well. And if I'm saying that video and audio testing, you may be thinking like most of the web application right now on web, only I have seen Angular apps, I only have seen React apps, right? But trust me, I have been into the industry, like I have worked with a couple of folks where game testing, especially related to players, audio testing, right? This is like a major kind of a testing that they do. And where Selenium is nearly not helpful in that case. So again, video testing, audio testing, CAPTCHA, sometimes you have to do file download and upload. And again, this is a very big use case where Selenium nearly lacks about how you can do a file uploading and downloading. Like there are like a couple of hacks using Robert class and all, but again, that's flaky. If you have tried, then it will mix. For video testing and all, we have basically created custom tools, as well as there are a couple of libraries I can discuss about from Google and Microsoft, especially from the Netflix side. They provide a couple of libraries in GitHub, which are again command line and not much mature, but will help you to get the bit rates of video testing, right? If your streaming is working fine or not, right? These kind of stuff, they will provide it. I can discuss more over the chat if you want to know. Right, Vasant? Awesome. So you have to add any kind of a third party libraries to add features like reporting, email, right? If you want to do that, that's again the limitations of part of it. Selenium. So what is Selenium? Again, it's a simple, it's a suite, right? We have Selenium WebDriver, we have IDE, we have Grid. Right. So right now Selenium 4 is coming. So that's what people are lots of excited. Again, it took nearly 2 years to launch Selenium 4. So again, the features are, I would say, good, but not much decent. But I would say we are excited because Selenium 4 is coming. Right. So if we talk about the Selenium WebDriver, right. So Selenium WebDriver is nothing but it's a web framework, or I would say it's a collection of APIs that will help you to automate any kind of web application or cross-browser testing if you want to do. In a nutshell, it's just a collection of APIs, methods that you have seen, probably have seen like get, getting a URL, like navigating and all, right? These kind of stuff, which basically help you to automate browsers, right? So this is an important question, which is explaining Selenium WebDriver architecture, right? So let me share guys, this is for the beginners especially. And if you already know this concept, please just a revision for you. So Selenium, what is the actually WebDriver concept? And this is one of the important interview question where people will ask you about the Selenium WebDriver architecture, right? And so this is how actually it works. Suppose you are a client. So you basically give a command to taxi driver, right? and driver understand English. So you will basically tell the driver that, okay, I want to go to this destination, right? So driver will understand your wish and start the car and go to the destination. And driver uses the car to go to the destination, right? So that's what actually they are doing. So similar way, we have this thing. We have Selenium language bindings, like the code that you're writing in Java, Python, code, or Ruby, right? It basically, you are using a JSON wire protocol, and that with this protocol, you are communicating with the browser driver, right? And that browser driver is basically communicating with your browser, and it basically giving instruction. So whenever you are basically saying in your Java file that driver.getgoogle.com, it will basically make an HTTP request with a JSON payload to the browser driver. And the browser driver will basically understand this request that, okay, you want to go to this URL, and it will basically send an instruction to the browser in this case, right? I hope this is clear. Type clear in the comment, guys, if this is clear. And this is an important question. That's why I wanted to make a simple slide to get you the basics if you are still struggling to understand, right? And now the people will ask me that, okay, this is actually a Selenium 3. What about Selenium 4, right? What happens? What is the W3 protocol? What happens, right? Nothing changes, guys. Nothing changes. It is just a fluff. If we talk about everything that you have right now, what's happening is that whenever we were using JSON wire protocol, right, it is just now becomes industry standards, which is basically now recognized by the W3. Right. So if you go to their website, right, it's just a W3 Selenium. Yes, definitely. I'll show you. Right. If you go to this thing, which is their specification of Selenium, right, you can read more about it. Again, it's similar way. They have changed a couple of new things. So again, same thing is there. If you want to create a new sessions, you have to just give the capabilities. You have to give the browser name, and it will start the, basically driver will start it, right? Right now, everything that you are seeing, like JSON protocols and all, these are now recognized by the W3C. So that's what it's happening. So again, if I show you that all the things related to the parts here, the smaller parts between them, right? It is now recognized by the W3. That's what happening in 4. Right, so nothing major. If you want to see, a couple of folks are asking, can we see Selenium HTTP calls request, right? So how exactly it's happening? So let me show you one demo. Okay, so I have prepared for you guys. Let me show you a Postman. And this is an important concept. Nobody actually talks about it. But if you are, let me know. Let me show you the thing. Right. Okay. Well, I need to stop share. Right. Guys, if you're able to see the Postman screen, let me know in the comment. Type one in the comment if you're seeing the request. Okay. Awesome. So, this is behind the scene, and this is a little, I would say a little advanced stuff, but what's happening, it's very simple way. Let me show you. So let me share my screen, full screen first. Desktop one, yes. And let me know, guys, also that if you are able to see the console also. Type one in the comment if you are able to see the console also. Right. This is one for console, right? Okay. So what I have done is that I have already downloaded the alpha version here, right? I'll show you where you can download it. Don't worry. So just wanted to show one thing quickly, the demo part. Okay. So couple of things, like I have already downloaded Chrome driver as well as the Gecko driver. I put it into the web driver path, right? So make sure your path especially have these drivers installed. In Mac, it's very straightforward. What you can do in Mac is directly just create a new folder like web drivers, right? And you can directly do vim sudo vim extra. Here you can type path. It's paths or path. Let me see. Okay, it's asking password. Let me enter that. Yeah, in the paths you have to just write this path, right? Paths file, and you can do like, let me do quick, right? And if you are on Windows, you just use that. Basically, go to my computer, right click on properties, add environment variables, right? And just add the directory where you have basically your Chrome driver as well as Chrome driver downloaded, right? Makes sense. It's pretty straightforward. If you are still struggling with the drivers, let me know. I'll share you a couple of Stack Overflow links, which are definitely to the point, which are definitely to the point, right? So let me show you a quick demo about it. So what exactly right now I'm doing is, I'm running a Selenium server, right? I'm going to show you one important thing, right? Just ignore the command as of now. We are running it. So, okay. Right. Awesome. So what you can do is that if you see, I'm actually making an API request, right? So I have shown you in the demo also, right? So what exactly we are doing, you have a language binding, which basically makes a HTTP request to your browser driver. And you basically tells if you want to start a new session or not. So in Selenium, the first thing happen is that you will provide the capability. In capability, basically you will mention what is the platform there, right? So right now I'm using Mac. If you don't mention it, it will basically automatically pick up the platform also. And you can also add that, okay, I want Chrome and Firefox. So I am starting a session, but I'm not sure which browser I will start as of now, right? But I am mentioning you that I want the session in Mac and see if you have Chrome and Firefox installed, right? So if you do this request, it's a post request again to starting it, right? And you will see that it will automatically, so it is, the request has gone to the driver and driver has automatically opened up the browser now. So whatever the things that you are basically doing, the payload, the session request that you are making, eventually whenever you are doing from code, right, it's basically making a same request here. Are you able to get it, guys? Let me know in the comment. Type 2 in the comment if you're able to understand. So whatever in the Java bindings or the things that you are entering like driver.get, driver.navigate, right? It basically converting the same API. It's basically hitting the same API. This is the same API actually they are hitting. Right, this is internal. And trust me, if you tell this thing to the any kind of interviewer who is asking you this concept, how Selenium WebDriver works, they will be very impressed by you, but you know the interior of that Selenium, how it exactly is going. So in a nutshell, in Selenium 4, nothing changes, just the structure of this system. So previous to that, we have a different JSON structure, but right now you can use capability in Selenium 4. You can use first match, always match, right? This kind of stuff. So right now, I have done a post request, but basically I have created a new session, right? Now in this session, I can do this thing, which is, let me change this to localhost right now. So since we are using most of the things on localhost, so you can do that. And here, this is your session ID that is basically you have created, right? Let me see. In the body part, whatever the results we are getting. So we have it basically telling us this is the session ID. How did you find these API calls? Okay, I'll tell you, Nilan, how you can get it. So this is a session ID that we are getting. It's basically telling us that about the we have browser number is there. So I have created a session and browser has returned this information that, okay, my name is basically I am a Chrome browser. This is my number. This is my driver version, right? This is my temp directory that I am using. And this is the debugging address that you can use from me. And couple of more proxy. I don't have any kind of a proxy. If you have Selenium option, CDB, like couple of other informations. Right, it's telling me. Now, if you basically, you can use this session ID now. Now, if you basically, right now, if you see, I have added a dynamic variable, right? And I'm telling that hitting a particular endpoint, which is URL. And here I'm telling that I want to navigate to this site, which is sdet.live, right? So in a nutshell, whatever the command that you're writing in the Selenium, right? For example, driver.get, it's similar to this thing. So driver.get is eventually making this request internally. They are making a post request to your session ID, which is session already created. And they are basically sending you this payload. Make sense? If I do a send request, you see that it will basically open up if you see it's happening, right? And right now, sdet.live is basically navigated to learn.testingacademy.com as of now. So it is basically has opened this thing, right? If I do get title, right? And again, I need to change the local IP. Basically right now, my local IP has changed again due to the I have dynamic one, right? And if you see here, you will get the title also. So you are it is returning, it's the title, right? So whenever you do driver.getTitle, right? It's a similar command that you are basically doing here. Similarly, you can do back also. So let me see if it is running. Null. So back, if you see, it is again. So forward, if you see, and this is a backward. Make sense? So again, all the command that you have seen, they have a particular APIs behind it. That's why I wanted to share, right? And if we talk about again, let's move on to slide again, right? So similar way, if you have seen, right? Are you able to see the slides, guys? Type one in the comment. You are, right? So similar things are happening in the through the JSON via protocol or the protocol. You are basically making a HTTP request to your drivers, and drivers are eventually doing the stuff. Make sense? This is how internally it's worked. It's pretty straightforward, so you know, web architecture. And near future, if someone asks you, please explain these concepts. I'm gonna share this collection with you. You can play around with this. I'm going to tell you the commands also, so you can use this command to do that also. The collection you can download from this website, sdet.live. I'm going to share this slide, so don't worry about it. You can play around with this. So every command that you have seen, like driver.navigate.move, timeout, right, they have a particular API request behind it. And how did I get this thing right here? So if we go to web driver specifications, right? So you can see they have, right? New sessions. So they are basically telling you how you can do that. You can use these capabilities, okay, right? And they'll eventually tell you how you can do that. So this is actually, they are telling you that you have to make a session request, post session. So your IP, right? What is your IP? It is basically localhost 404444, when we started, we have used a port, right? So localhost 444 and slash session with the capabilities, whatever that you are setting, it will basically open up the first one, basically the Chrome in that case. Now, again, if you want to get the current URL, you can use session ID slash URL, right? All the things they are telling you, that every command or everything that you have seen, right? Sys to window, right? They are nothing but the APIs behind it. Make sense? This is new. If it is new, type new in the comment, guys. If it is new for you, right? Okay. For Vinay, it's new. Anu, it's new. Pratik is new. New plus old, Manish. Okay, I got it. No problem. Right. So this is actually behind the scene Selenium. Nothing. Selenium again. Whatever the code that you are writing, again, it is converting all the things into the APIs. Guys, it's all about APIs. I told you in the beginning, right? Most of the things are in APIs. And so right now, if you see the bindings that you're writing, it's nothing but a front end for you. In a nut, it's not exactly, please don't say in interview that it's a front end, but I'm just saying that all the code that you're writing is eventually getting converted. For example, you are writing Java code, it's basically converted into bytecodes, and eventually it is using the JSON via protocol, eventually sending the API request to the browsers, browser drivers, and browser drivers are basically able to understand this request, and they are basically processing that request. What type of server are we sending requests to? Not sure what I missed. Okay, so right now we are running a Selenium standalone servers. The standalone server basically takes your API request and understands it and send it to the drivers, and driver will basically eventually do the stuff for us. Yeah. Right, cool. Okay, awesome, guys. All right. So that's how you can do that, right? So again, I told you that Selenium 4 is nothing but what's happening is that most of the protocols that we have seen, like JSON-WIR protocol and all, right, they are now recognized by W3. So Chrome browser, Firefox browser, IE, Opera, right, it's now standard. So these methods, so whichever methods that WebDriver right now it's telling on this link, right, all these methods like sys to window, get window handles, all these endpoints, basically eventually these are endpoints, right, has to be supported by the browser vendor. It means, so every browser who is basically supported, who's basically use the w3.org, which is called as worldwide, what is called, I don't remember the full form, but you know this, right, W3C basically, right? So every browser like Chrome browser, Firefox, Opera, IE, these all, Safari, right, these all supports this thing. These basically follow these guidelines of W3, right? They have to now basically give these kind of stuff, right? It is now recommended. Even if a new browser is coming, suppose there is another new browser, like Russia launches suppose a new browser, and if it starts, it basically follows this W3.org, then it basically eventually be supporting these things. Like they have to write their own logic in their drivers. Make sense? So it's just a recognition that happened in the Selenium 4. Nothing changes. Not much changes, I would say. But it's a big change for us because now, right now, new browser is already supported. So sometimes what happens is that, for example, there's a dismiss alert, right? It is implemented by Chrome, but it's not implemented by Firefox, right? But now every browser has to implement this endpoint, and now everything is standard. That's what that's happened, right? Which is actually a big change, I would say. Awesome, guys. And a couple of other things are also changed, like sending up the request. If you have seen, they will basically tell you the old way as well as new way. Somewhere around they will tell you that what are the things that has been changed. Capability, I guess it's okay. Right. Perfect. So guys, what you can do is that, so suppose I want to run my first Selenium test, right? So what I can do is that I can run a standalone server, right? So standalone server is basically everything that you are seeing related to creating your sessions, communicating with drivers, right? Everything that you are seeing, it basically, whenever you run this jar file, it will basically automatically will handle from your binding. So whatever the binding code that you're writing, it will automatically send to the server. The server will basically understand everything and communicate with your driver. Driver will basically understand the request. It will basically do the action that you have already told in the bindings. So binding by mean is basically whatever the code that you're writing that in your Java file, Python file, Ruby file, right? So it is basically doing the same thing, right? So let me move back where it is. So to do that, what you need to do is that, like, I'm going to show you in the IntelliJ. So let me open the IntelliJ. You can do the similar stuff in your Eclipse also, right? So it's pretty much straightforward. Right. Let me try. So what you can do, okay, let me check, right. Go to selenium.dev. Right, you can basically click on download, right? And if you see, we have Selenium SID server grain. It's nothing but a standalone jar file, right? If you click on it, you will have a download option. Just download it, right? So we are right now downloading the 3.14 version, which is the most stable one. You can download the 4.0 alpha version, right? But I will recommend to start with 3.41 versions to getting started, right? So now let's switch to the IntelliJ. Let me screen share again. Where is IntelliJ? Right. Okay. So I have written a couple of code for you. So let's remove it again. Pretty much straightforward. Guys, if you are able to see this IntelliJ, like type two in the comment if you are able to see it. Awesome. It means everything works, right? So in IntelliJ as well as on Eclipse, what you can do is that you can create a new project, right? You can download the IntelliJ by going to website of JetBrains, right? I hope you have already done this. This is like simpler program. We are creating a Java project. We are using a 11.04 version. We are right now not creating any Maven project or Maven project. So Maven project is basically used for dependency management. That is like an advanced stuff. Right now we are just creating a simpler program of command line. I'm going to show you some basic concept in it that if you are missing, just a revision for you. You can click on next. I'm just creating a command line app, right? And here I can type hello Selenium, right? And okay, Selenium is already there. So let's say demo. Let's make it new window, right? So make sure that your Java and everything is working, because it will give you an error. If you are new, totally new to this, I hope when we were covering some Rust Assured, you have already done it, this concept. So make sure your hello, at least hello world is running. So right now I'm running the hello world, if you see, right? So hello world is running now. Awesome. So let me see if I'm sharing the correct screen. Give me 1 second. Share desktop one. Right. Awesome. Right. So this is the code that we are basically working on. No. Right. So I have already downloaded the jar. So what you can do here is that you can directly go to the open module setting, right? In the libraries, click on plus icon, jar. Similar way in the Eclipse also, you can directly add the external jars, right? So I'm just selecting the jar file, right? And it will ask me to add, okay, apply, right? So now what you can do directly is that, so I'm gonna write a first program, which is WebDriver. So you can directly call the WebDriver, and let me tell you what is it. You cannot do WebDriver.driver, right? So if you do, you have to implement everything. So WebDriver here, if you see, it's an interface, right? It's an interface. Why it is an interface? Let me show you. It's WebDriver. It's basically, if you see, it's an interface, right? Here, if you want to see what is a WebDriver, you can directly click on the IntelliJ. It will basically give you the original file, basically kind of a source code of it, right? And if you see, it is again extends another interface which is called a search context. And search context has two element, which is find elements and find element. I'm going to tell you what exactly it is, right? And if you see WebDriver, it's an interface, guys. It's not a class. So interface basically means in Java, it basically means that it will have a certain methods, right? Let me know if you agree with me. It will have a certain methods which are abstract in nature, which basically whoever basically implement this interface, right? Whatever class it will basically implement this interface, they have to write their own code about the methods that basically this interface talk about, right? So why WebDriver is an interface? This is an important question, right? It's an interface because we have different browsers, right? We can have Chrome browser, Firefox browser, Opera, IE, right? Different browser will have a different types of implementation. Means to get a particular title, Firefox can have a different implementation, like Chrome can have a different implementation, right? So WebDriver basically talks about that, okay, these are the common method I want you, all of you, to include in your classes, right? So all the method like get is basically used to navigate to a particular URL, right? Get current URL, title, find element. These are coming from the search context, right? So search context is basically the parent interface, which contains find element and the find elements. And after that, we have web drivers. We have web driver methods, which are again abstract. If you see, they don't have any kind of a definitions. So Chrome driver and Firefox driver, IE driver, they basically implement all these functions. So let me show you how. So let's suppose I want to do, hey, let's do a Firefox driver, which is the easiest one, right? And if you open the Firefox, right here, this is the Firefox class. And as you can, it basically IntelliJ is telling us that, okay, I have decompiled your class, right? And if you see, they have implemented all the, so basically they are, if you see, extending a class which is called as remote web driver and implementing the web driver in that case. So they have basically, if you see somewhere, you will see that those methods are basically getting implemented for that web driver, right? So again, we are basically creating an instance of a web driver from this Firefox, right? So this is an object. So now driver, if we want to do, for example, if you do dot, you will see lots of different methods which are already available. If you see, most of these methods are basically available in the web driver interface, right? And get method is now implemented by this class Firefox driver, right? So you can directly do, for example, go to scrolltest.com. And here is the basic concept. This is a class. This is a interface. Make sure you know that. And here the get method, it is an interface which is implemented by driver class. Now, two things are basically I'm missing here is that setting up your driver path, right? So right now, if you do directly like this, it basically assumes that your drivers are in your path, already added in your path, right? If you do even Chrome driver, right now it will work for me because my web drivers or my drivers for Chrome driver as well as the Gecko drivers are already downloaded and added to my path, right? And how we can check it out. So let me show you one thing. Okay. Let me stop share. Let me share the desktop too. Yeah. Okay. So you can download the Chrome driver from here, guys. Just type Chrome driver. You will see chromedriver.com. Okay, chromedriver.com. This is not a correct one, guys. Let me share the screen. You can type Google Chrome driver, right? Able to see the screen, right? Yes. Now it's visible, right? Yes. Okay. So you can go to chromedriver.chromium.org and make sure one of the thing is that right now Chrome 87 is launched. So make sure you download this one. So if you see, you have Linux 64, Mac 64 means all of them are available. So I can download this thing. And I have basically added to my web driver directory where this directory is I have added to path. And similar way, if you're using Windows, you can do basically download this into a particular library, particular folder, and add that folder into your environmental path variable, right? It's pretty straightforward. If you are still confused, I would suggest you Chrome driver to path, right? You will see Stack Overflow. Like they will basically tell you how you can do that in the Windows instruction. Yes, so you can use like this. Or another way you can do directly, which is straightforward. I have already told you in, let me show you this demo here, right? So you can use a system.set property, and you can mention that webdriver.chrome driver, and this is your path of your driver, right? You can do that also. The similar thing will work in Mac also, if you want. So what I have done is that I have added into path, so I don't have to mention this statement every time, right? So you can remove this. And even in the code, even in the CI/CD, whenever we are doing CI/CD, we generally do is that we generally add. So most of the time CI/CD, whenever we are doing any kind of a CI/CD Jenkins and all, right, we have a Linux-based servers, and Linux-based server pretty much supports straightforward adding to the path. So you can just use a simple command, which is called export path, and just add your directory where you have downloaded your Chrome drivers, and it works in a simpler way, right? So all three methods I have told you, like the first, if you are still struggling, you can use the basic one, which is system.set property. And you have, if you're using Firefox, you can use, instead of Chrome, you can use Firefox here. Instead of Chrome, you can use IE here also. And here you can give the directory here. So where you will get this one, I'm gonna show you, let me show you. So stop share again, move back to my original one. Right, code. So here before creating your driver, you can basically do that, right? So if in Mac, basically if suppose it's a temp Chrome driver, right? Suppose it's a temp directory. So in Mac generally we do like this. So you can do the same thing, right? It will work in a similar way. So right now I have like documents, and between that I have web driver also, right? So you can do the similar way. Similarly for Firefox also, you will see like this thing, right? But for me, I have already added my path, Firefox driver path. So it will work in the similar way. So you can run this program and let's see if it is running fine for us. And if everything is working fine for you, you will see that, okay, MozRunner, and here you will see Firefox open. Guys, are you able to see the Firefox? Type one in the comment if you are able to see. And if you see, right? Okay. So this is running, right? Pay attention to these small things, guys, here. That the concept here is the WebDriver one, which is an interface which contains the methods about different methods, and Firefox here is a class, right? And let me show you one thing all here. So let me open up a browser. Okay, browser is already here. Let me stop share and screen again. So I'm going to show you one more thing, which is called as Web Driver Hierarchy. Web Driver Interface, let's see. And I suppose yes, here it is. So you can use this one, which is simpler one. Right. So let me open, not open, guys. Right. So, generally, what we have is that the first thing, we have a search context interface, right? The search context interface is basically telling that, okay, whoever class is implementing me, right? This is like a parent interface, right? They should know two things, that how to find a particular element and how to find elements, right? This will return a list and this will return a particular element, right? So search context is an interface, which is like a parent one, right? And after that parent, we have WebDriver interface, if you see here. And this interface contains abstract methods like get, URL, close, quit, right? And a couple of more interfaces that basically the class who is implementing can implement. I know, guys, it's a little bit complex to understand first, but trust me, one of the important interview questions. Like what are the methods in abstract methods in WebDriver interface? What is the parent of the WebDriver, right? So we have a parent, which is search context, and it contains two things, right? And after that, it is basically a remote WebDriver class. If you see, it is implements WebDriver one, and remote WebDriver again getting extended by all the browsers classes. Right. If I have shown you, right, Firefox basically, if you see, extends the remote WebDriver class and implement these interfaces. So interfaces, we have to implement them, and whatever the classes that we have, we can extend them. Right. So remote WebDriver will contain like JavaScript executor, screenshots, and all. Right. So Firefox and IE, Chrome, Opera, all of them will basically do the same. So this is important diagram. So let me also. So you can go through this one again. It's the first interface for class, contain two abstract methods. Again, you can read more about it. I'll share a couple of links where you can learn from the official website rather than going to some other tutorials. Make sense? All right. So that's actually about the web driver, right? And let's jump to again back to our Selenium. All right. So let me see if you are still okay. Awesome, guys. Perfect. Good. So we have seen, we have basically started our first program, which is simple one, which is just navigating to a particular endpoint, right? And now let's talk about little bit about the IDE. I won't recommend to learn more about the Selenium IDE, but I would highly recommend to go through it at least once, because sometimes people ask, have you used IDE? And if it is the thing that we can use it here, right? As a tester, we should know about it. So again, if you talk about Selenium IDE, is a basically open source record and playback tool. And how it looks like, it basically looks like this. Okay, it's opening on the second window right now. But are you able to see the Selenium IDE, guys? Type one in the comment if you are seeing it. Yes, okay. Right. So it looks like various record. It's kind of a record and playback kind of a tool. And it basically uses a language which is called as Selenide. And you, what you can do is that you can launch a particular IDE here, right? And if you see similar to this, you can, if you use it, it works very simpler way. For example, you can record a new test. So if you do, so like, let's say test one, right? And here you will basically say that base URL, let's go to bing.com, right? If you do that bing.com, it will basically open up. And here, if you see, it's basically telling that I'm recording. And let's say if I say, hello, Google, Google Assistant will come and let's open this URL, right? And here, if you see, if you right click on it, you will see Selenium IDE options. You can basically assert this title, right? And you can also do one more, couple of more options like verify the text, right? And after that, you can basically move back to your, if you see like, you can basically stop it here. You can save the test, Bing test, save, right? And if you see every action that you are basically doing, right? So you have done an open command. So it's just a command to open a particular link, which is the bing.com. So we have opened bing.com and it just appended this thing, which is nothing but some query parameter, which doesn't make sense. We have used set window, which basically set it to a window to a particular resolution. We have clicked to this IDE, right? This is a element or a locator. This is, we have typed something, right? So this is a command. And we have sent keys.enter. We have sent, this is the links that we wanted to check. This is the assertions that I have added. Again, so Selenium IDE is very good fit for any kind of a beginner. And if you are a new, I would highly recommend you try out once at least. So if you save it, you can use Control S to save it. And it will basically save as a side file, .side file, right? You can save it in somewhere. And if you click on this current, right, it will basically start executing your test again. If you see, we have typed hello.google, typed in like first result is clicked, and yeah, everything is passed. So we have a successful run, right? At least, guys, I would recommend you as a SDET, we should try at least once Selenium IDE. At least you should know about it, right? How to write it. Few more things that you can do apart from this is that you can add your custom commands. Like there is a concept of if loop as well here also, if else, you can do times, you can run multiple times a particular command. But again, I will recommend just try out record and play and see if it is helpful for you or not in your company, right? 90% of the time you will not be using it. And if you are, then definitely go through some other tutorials, I would say, right? So you can say, you can record your test cases in suite as well as in test, right? And, you can also run the same thing by using node command, right? So you can install Selenium SideRunner. And let me show you how you can do that. So basically you, for this, you need to install the node, right? And after that, you can run Selenium Side Server and give the side file and it will run the same thing, right? Rather than using a Chrome extension, you can do by using the command line also, the similar way, right? There's a code export also, which is again, a great feature for this thing, which most of the people generally do open existing one. Let's open test one.side, right? Here, if you do export, you can export to the Java. You can directly export it. And Bing text test, right? So let's open this file also. If you see, it has done the same thing that we, the code, the same code is nearly same that we have done. It has just added two more methods, which are just a JUnit method to initialize the driver, nothing else. Right? Are you able to see the Sublime, guys? Type one in the comment if you're seeing this here, guys. Yes, okay. So it has done the same thing, if you see. I did lots of dependency. I did couple of some advanced stuff, which is nothing but a JUnit teardown and a setup method, which is like a prescript and test script that you have seen in API testing also, right? Setup is prescript, teardown is just a test script after post-testing. Basically pre-testing, post-testing after you're done. So before making a request, we want to initialize a Chrome driver, JavaScript executor, hash map. And after we are done, we want to quit the driver, right? And this is your test, which is basically nothing but opening a bing.com, right? Adding the size. So basically to make a new size, I mean to say resolution, you can use 190 by 937. You can use manage.windows. After that, there is a concept of find element that I'm going to show you in a simpler way, right? Basically doing the steps one by one. So this is how you can export your Selenium IDE scripts to the, which is sometimes helpful whenever we are dealing with some, if you want to create something in a very short time, you can definitely leverage Selenium IDE. Just record your scenarios and export it correctly to the, and after that, use them directly in your frameworks. But most of the time, it will not be helpful, but sometimes it is. Make sense? Awesome, guys. Awesome. Okay. So this is actually the concept of Selenium IDE. Let's come to the Selenium grid. So, So what exactly is a Selenium grid? Let me show. So Selenium grid is nothing but a smart proxy, or I would say not smart. It's actually a very intelligent proxy, right? That basically allow you to run your test case parallelly, right? Pay attention now, because Selenium grid is one of the important concept. And if you are any kind of a senior SDET or an automation engineer, or at least if you are somewhere around 3+ years or 2+ years, you need to pay attention now. This is one of the important concept, which is Selenium grid. So Selenium grid is nothing but it's a proxy server, right? It basically reroutes your whatever the request that you are sending. For example, if you have created a particular test case, right? I want to log into a particular website, or I want to go to this particular website, right? It can route your request to appropriate node, right? It basically means, for example, I want to run it on a Windows and I want to run out Windows Firefox, right? So if I have a grid is nothing but a collection of machines which are connected each with each other, right? And if I want it, if I have a Windows machine there in my grid and I have a Firefox installed in that machine, if I run this test on my grid, it will basically reroute to that machine, run the test, and basically give you back the result. That is a amazing concept, right? So major component of Selenium grid is nothing but two things, which is hub and node. Hub basically means it is a manager. If you say in a simple way, it's a manager, and nodes are nothing but the real machines that you have attached to this manager. So it's a very simpler way. For example, whenever a task come to a manager, right? Manager basically noted down what is the task, and it will basically check who can do this task. So nodes are nothing but his employees, if you say in a simpler way. And if he thinks that, okay, node 3 can do it better, it will basically pass the request to this node 3. Node 3 will execute the test and it will give you the result and it again, and give you the back the result. So this is a diagram, official diagram, if you have seen. We have client basically nothing but the code that you are writing. For example, IntelliJ right now, you're using Eclipse and all, right? You are using any kind of a binary like Java, Ruby, Cucumber, right? So eventually you are making a request to hub. Now you are not making to a standalone server, you are making to a hub, right? Nothing changes actually. You just change one thing, which is rather than using directly Firefox or Chrome, you are basically need to create a remote web driver class now, right? So because these are remote machines, they can be anywhere in your, they should be in a particular single network there, but they can be into different region probably, right? So network should be same. Now, what will happen? You will just basically use a remote web driver class. You will basically tell, okay, my grid is running at localhost 444. And I'll basically tell, okay, what kind of capability I want to run. Basically, what kind of test case I want to run on which machine. So I need to mention, okay, I want to run on Mac or Windows. I want to run on Firefox. So nodes are basically connected to hub. And if a hub is able to find a correct node, which is attached to this grid, then it will basically execute that test and basically give you. If you see in the diagram, we have Windows machine attached, we have Linux machine, we have Mac, and there's another mobile web browser is also, if you see, attached, right? So as well as the Android web driver. So you can basically test in multiple machine. This will allow you to two important thing, which is parallel execution as well as the cross browser testing that you can do. So that's where the Selenium Grid is so helpful, right? So when to use the Selenium Grid? So guys, before moving to this, are you able to understand the concept of hub and node? Type one in the comment if you are able, if you are clear with this. If you are already clear with this. Right. So when now the question arises, when we use Selenium Grid, right? When to use any kind of Selenium Grid, right? So simplest answer is this basically, that you will use the Selenium Grid whenever you require any kind of a multiple browsers, right? You want to run your test case on multiple browsers. You want to reduce your time of your test cases. For example, you have 5,000 test cases and you want to reduce the time to minimum, right? What you will do is that you will basically create a grid which contain multiple machine, and that will basically run your test cases or distribute your test cases among the nodes, right? One more thing is that sometimes if you want to do cross browser testing, for example, if you want to run your test case on Chrome also, Firefox also, Opera also, IE also, right? Then you can use the Selenium Grid in that case also. All right. So how to start a Selenium Grid? So this is the grid that we are talking about. It's a Selenium 3 grid. Make sure you know that, right? It's pretty straightforward. So let me show you practically how you can do that. Let me stop share and let's come back to desktop one. Right. Let's close this one. Awesome, guys. So are you able to see my screen, which is console, guys? Let me know in the comment. Type 2 in the comment if you are able to see the screen. Guys, be interactive because we're gonna learn something important here. And if you haven't started the grid from log bag, you will learn the things. Okay. Right. So if you see, I have already downloaded the standalone jar. This is 3.114, guys. This is not a 4. Okay. This is a standalone jar that I have downloaded. Now you can use a similar jar to create the Selenium grid. You don't have to download separate jar for it. So only single jar will basically act, can help you to create your Selenium grid, right? So what you can do is that you need to use Java minus jar that we have already used, Selenium standalone, right? Now here is the thing, you are basically telling this. So assume this thing. This console, which is this one, tab one, which is a separate machine. This will be a separate machine. So let me do one thing. Let me name them. So you can do edit session here. And you can basically add. So let's say PC one. So let's say this is hub. This is suppose this is a different machine, right? Now just suppose it. And this is again, this is your node, okay? This is your node. Let me remove this thing. Right. And again, this is your node 2. Suppose these are three different computers. Two different computers are basically attached. Node 2. Okay. So this is your node 1. No, this is your hub node. Okay. Right. Makes sense. Okay. So we are running the first thing. If you see, it's basically telling that, okay, so I have started Selenium server. And I have started on a port 444. And it's basically telling you that, okay, grid is up and running because we have added a role as a hub. It's already telling that grid is up and running. There is no node actually. There's only one thing running, which is manager, right? And if you open this link, right, nothing will happen in that case. So again, you will get 500. So just clear it out for as of now, right? So we have successfully run over grid as of now, right? And now what you need to do is that you are basically running on a second machine, right? So in the second machine also, we have everything, same thing. We have a similar version of a standalone available. We have browsers also, browser drivers also available here. You can use driver.jar, right? Selenium, I'm gonna write this thing. Now in the role, you are basically telling node, right? And in the hub, you need to give the hub path. So hub is running at localhost. If you see, most of the time it will basically, you need to give the path of to register, which is basically again given by the already given by this in the console log of previous one, right? And if you see registered, you see it is basically telling that, okay, I have registered a grid now, right? And the node is now ready to use, right? And similar way, suppose this is my third computer, I can do the same thing again. So now you will see, okay, another one is also done, right? So these are two nodes connected to this hub, right? Clear till now, guys? Type three in the comment. It is clear till now. Okay, for Vinay it's clear. Okay, so what we are doing here is that we are just created a hub where, and we have attached two nodes. So consider it as a different computers right now in they are on single machine, but consider as in separate machines. So these are three on a same network. Make sure they are on a same network, guys. And that's why we prefer at AWS or any kind of a Docker environments like GCPs and all, because they provide similar networks, similar region networks, right? So that's where you can create your own Selenium grid. And after that, I'll basically tell you how to create into Docker also similar things, right? So now I have everything available, right? If I want to check it out, I can, right, give me one second. Yeah. Right. So let me show you how the console looks like, right? So this is how actually if you open this URL, right, 444 grid console, you will see there is a one node which is connected, this one as OS Mac, right? And this is again an OS Mac again connected. So these are two nodes are connected, right? If you are using any other machine, for example, if I was using any kind of Windows machine, you will see OS as a Windows. If you are connected to any Linux, it will be Linux, Android, OS, all the things are created. So right now in our grid, we have two nodes connected. And what they can do is that they can basically, it's basically telling you that, okay, I can use 5 Firefox and 5 Chrome. So if I have like 10 test case, I can run on node one. And if I have 10 test case, if I have like 20 test cases, I can run by 10 by 10, like 10 on Firefox and 10 on Chrome, right? So that's an awesome thing, right? So that we can do here. So let me show you how you can do that, the running part. So let's open up the simple demo. I'm going to share my screen. So let's share the desktop one. Right. So now if you want to run on grid, right, you just need two more things, which is basically telling the capabilities. Like here we are basically using a method which is called as desired capability, a class, and we are telling that I want to run on Chrome. Right, if you want to run on Firefox, you can do that also, right? So we have dot Firefox, right? If you do Safari, you can do Safari also, right? So let's make it Chrome again. And in the capability, you can mention that, okay, I want to set that, okay, I want to run on Chrome. I can also set my platform. So suppose I want to run on Windows, right? So I can type Windows here, but I don't have Windows attached as a node as of now, right? So I cannot do that, but I'm just showing you some demo. You can do browser name. You can say JavaScript available or not, set version. You can set the versions of your Chrome. For example, if you want to run on different, if you have a different version, you can do that, right? So a couple of capabilities that I'm just adding. Now, you are not creating a Chrome driver here, right? Because we are using a grid now, which contains in hub as well as node one and node two. We need to use a remote web driver. The remote web driver needs two things, which is your URL where your grid is running. So grid most of the time will be running on your local host 444 WD hub. But if you are using a cloud kind of environment, you have to use your public IP here, right? Or if you are using a grid which is local or internal, right? If you are basically using any kind of a AWS grid or GCP, they will have a private IP. They will have a certain kind of IP like 10.4.5, something like this, right? They have some private IPs. So you will basically have to enter the correct IP. So right now I'm running my grid on localhost. So that's why I will just mention it as a localhost here. Make sense? And here you just need to give the capability. Capability basically talk about that, okay, I have two nodes right now, and which node I want to basically access and what kind of test I'm running. So I'm just telling you that I want Chrome capabilities and I want to run this test on my Chrome, right? So let's run it quickly and see if it is running fine. Okay. So are you able to see the screen of Chrome, guys? Let me know in the comment. Type one in the comment if you are seeing that Chrome is open. Okay, so yeah. So this is basically, if you see, I'll just do one thing more, right? And let me stop share and show you the screen of the console. What's happening in console, right? If you see console, node 2 Chrome has been used, right? And if you see, we have one direct one. It basically means that one session is running. And if you hover over it, basically telling you that's the last session and this is the session URL, right? So only session URL command has been executed and it's fade out, right? It basically means that my one Chrome is used, right? If I do a parallel execution, my all four will be used. So it will basically show you a fade out.
So I hope you have learned about the Selenium, Selenium IDE, how Selenium Grid works, and your first Selenium program where we have basically opened a particular URL and check it out, right? This was a crash course about it. I hope you have learned something new. Thanks for watching, and keep watching Testing Academy.